Good morning, everyone. Welcome to you all. Today is the 17th Sunday in the season of Pentecost. It's great to have you here for worship today. Great to have some of our friends online as well. I just have two announcements to share with you today. The second one is going to be a temple talk by Joel, who is the head of our stewardship committee, so we'll have him coming up in a moment. But the first one involves all of you potentially. This coming Saturday, we're having our Worship and Arts Conference. If you love worship or art or music, I hope that you will come and join us. It's free for all Trinity members. It's going to start at 9 o'clock and go into the afternoon, featuring Marty Haugen, that wonderful composer. In fact, he's the composer of the music we're singing in our liturgy today. This is Marty Haugen's setting of the liturgy. Marty Haugen is a great musician. Most of us recognize his name. We've been singing his hymns for 30 years or so. He's coming here to Trinity, and he's going to lead this conference here on Saturday. People from all over the region are coming in to join us. Our choir members are going to sing together with Marty in the afternoon and prepare themselves for a concert in the evening. And other choir members from all over town are coming together to sing with Marty. And in the evening, there's going to be a concert at Holy Spirit Parish at 7 p.m. So even if you don't come during the day, I do hope you will come to the evening concert at Holy Spirit Parish Saturday night at 7 p.m. Everyone's invited. There is no cost. Just a lot of fun and wonderful music. So please join us if you can. And if you're coming for the conference during the day, please sign up on our sign-up sheet back there because we need to know how many lunches to buy. And with that, I'll call upon Joel.
So this is the third week in our stewardship drive starting up. The last couple weeks, we've focused on two different parts of the theme of rising to our mission. Those were global and national focus. Global, we talked a little bit about Philip Knutson, our missionary. Last time, it was a little bit of highlighting of what our involvement in ELCA looks like. Today, I think that in your insert here, I think that the first sentence in that really highlights a lot. The first work of a congregation is to proclaim the gospel and engage in ministry within local communities. Now, we've all kind of rattled through the list before. We've heard it done from up here, and we've seen the impact that this congregation and its members and stuff has in our community. And we wanted to highlight that and have it be the final talk in our stewardship campaign, so that everybody remembers what a huge impact this congregation does have here locally. 2 weeks from now is the Appeal Sunday. We'll be sending out paperwork, the mail stuff, this week. So watch for that. And please return it, or come next 2 Sundays from now to return it, or mail it in or something like that, and after some prayerful consideration. Thank you.
Thank you, Joel. And of course, part of our stewardship as people of God is serving here at the congregation. And there is no greater need right now than to see that sign-up sheet back there. We have needs for ushers and for people to help make the communion bread and to set up the altar and all of that. All of them are very simple tasks, and it depends on all of us kind of pitching in one at a time together, or a few at a time. So please take a moment and sign up there as part of your stewardship for this fall as well. Are there any other announcements? Then I invite you to rise as we begin our service today with confession and forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. My friends, let us confess our sins in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to all of you the entire forgiveness of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us join together in our entrance song. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, in peace, let us pray to the Lord. Have mercy, Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. For the reign of God and for peace through Christ.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Benevolent, merciful God, when we are empty, fill us. When we are weak in faith, strengthen us. When we are cold in love, warm us, that with joy we may love our neighbors and serve them for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The first reading this morning comes to us from the book of Habakkuk. Habakkuk was an Old Testament prophet. About 600 BC is when he lived. Thank you. Lived about 600 BC. And he was upset with God because a lot of evil people were getting away with doing all sorts of terrible things, and God wasn't punishing them. And he was upset. And this is what God told him. God's answer was that he will deal with the wicked in his own time and in his own way. And until then, the people of faith, people, righteous people, should live with faith. The oracle that the prophet Habakkuk saw. O Lord, how long shall I cry for help, and you will not listen? Or cry to you, violence, and you will not save? Why do you make me see wrongdoing and look at trouble? Destruction and violence are before me. Strife and contention arise, and the laws become slack, and justice never prevails. The wicked surround the righteous. Therefore, judgment becomes perverted. I will stand at my watchpost and station myself on the rampart. I will keep watch to see what he will say to me and what he will answer concerning my complaint. Then the Lord answered me and said, write the vision, make it plain on tablets, so that a runner may read it. For there is still a vision for the appointed time. It speaks of the end and does not lie. It seems to tarry. Wait for it. It will surely come. It will not delay. Look at the proud. Their spirit is not right in them, but the righteous live by their faith. The word of the Lord.
It's not long until the boastful are silenced and shamed. It's not long until the wealth of the wicked's reclaimed. And the ones who have waited with eyes on the Lord will shine like the sun forevermore. It's not long till the day of the Lord. Just be still and be faithful and dwell in the land. Put your trust in the Savior and cling to his hand. When your heart with weapons of war, for the Lord. till the day of the Lord. It's not long till the day of the Lord. It's not long till the day of the Lord. Everything that is broken will soon be restored. It's not long till the day of the Lord. It's not long till the day of the Lord.
The second reading today comes to us from 2 Timothy. I need a lot of help. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God, for the sake of the promise of life that is in Christ Jesus, to Timothy, my beloved child, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I am grateful to God, whom I worship with a clear conscience as my ancestors did, when I remember you constantly in my prayers, night and day. Recalling your tears, I long to see you so that I may be filled with joy. I am reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that lived first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now, I am sure, lives in you. For this reason, I remind you to rekindle the gift of God that is within you through the laying on of my hands. For God did not give us a spirit of cowardice, but rather a spirit of power and love and of self-discipline. Do not be ashamed, then, of the testimony about our Lord, or of me, his prisoner, but join with me in suffering for the gospel, relying on the power of God who saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our work, but according to his own purpose and grace. This grace was given to us in Christ Jesus before the ages began, but it has now been revealed through the appearing of our Savior, Christ Jesus, who abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. For this gospel, I was appointed a herald and an apostle and a teacher, and for this reason, I suffer as I do. But I am not ashamed, for I know the one in whom I have put my trust, and I am sure that he is able to guard until that day what I have entrusted to him. Hold to the standard of sound teaching that you have heard from me in the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. Guard the good treasure entrusted to you with the help of the Holy Spirit living in us. The word of the Lord.
You may eat and drink. Do you thank the slave for doing what was commanded? So also, when you have done all that you were ordered to do, say, we are worthless slaves. We have done only what we ought to have done. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Good morning, Trinity Children of God. In the back of our sanctuary, in this sound booth, there are buttons and switches and sliders everywhere, in all different shapes and sizes. But there is one button, a small one, and if you press it, it will turn on all the lights all over this big room, and also all the lights in the Narthex and Trinity's library, all the way around to where they serve those treats on Sunday morning. And if you press another button of the same size, those same lights will slowly turn off. Just one button can do all those things. In our Bible reading, our gospel reading for this morning, Jesus' followers ask him a question. How can we have more faith? And Jesus says this, even if you have the faith the size of a mustard seed, it is going to be enough. Have any of you ever seen a mustard seed? It is one of the tiniest seeds. But the mustard seed doesn't stay small. It grows quickly and can actually become a very large plant that spreads everywhere. Jesus uses this example of a mustard seed to say to the disciples and to us that no matter what we think the size of our faith is, that God can use the faith that we do have, that God working through us can use that faith to do some amazing and wonderful things. Remember that small button? Well, it can turn on all these lights just as well as a large one can. God is going to use people, you and me, no matter the size of our faith, to bring God's light and to share God's love with others every single day, wherever it is we go. Let's pray. Dear God, we know that you are always with us. Help us believe that together we can accomplish great things. Amen. Have a great end to your weekend, everyone. Enjoy this nice fall day out there. I hope to see you again next Sunday. Bye for now.
Thank you, Todd. Dear friends in Christ, grace and peace to you from God, our Heavenly Father, and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Have you ever seen a faith healer at work? You ever seen that? Well, most of us wouldn't even know where to go to find such a thing. But maybe like me, you've been flipping through the TV channels and you come across one of these charismatic, flamboyant people who seems to be doing faith healings on television. And you stop and you watch and you're sort of fascinated and wondering, wow, does that really work? Can that preacher, can that evangelist have that much power in his faith? And you watch and you'll see people coming up on crutches, hobbling up onto stage, or some people being wheeled up in wheelchairs. And the faith healer comes with all of his flamboyance and he lays his hand on them and he prays a mighty prayer. And all of a sudden, the crutches go flying, the people jump up out of their wheelchair and they start walking around the stage and dancing and proclaiming praise to God for the miracle that has just happened. Have you ever seen that? Very interesting. And then sometimes you will see someone come up on their crutches and in their wheelchair, and the healer will lay hands on them and offer that mighty prayer, and nothing happens. And the person hobbles away on the crutches or is wheeled away in the chair, and you can see that they're dejected. And what's worse, they're despairing, which means they have lost hope. They have lost all hope. This was their last hope to be healed, and now it is gone. How very sad. I don't mean sad for them that they weren't healed. That's not quite what I mean. How very sad for us if we think that that's actually the way that faith works. Now, I'm not going to deny the possibility that God would do some miraculous healings on some of those stages. That's apparently happened through history. But it does make me a little suspicious, because it would be very easy to fake all of that stuff for television, wouldn't it? To have whole people come up on crutches and then dance away. Maybe God does work that way occasionally. We know he did that a lot in the Bible, in the Gospels. But how sad if that's the way people think about their faith. If you're healed, well, you must have tremendous, powerful faith. And if you are not healed, well, then your faith must be weak. And you don't have enough power in it for God to do what God wants to do, which is to heal you. The fault is yours because you don't have enough faith. Or is the power of the faith in the faith healer. And then why does it work one time and not another time? Is he that spotty? Since when has the Bible told us that God's gifts come to us only if we contribute our own part? It doesn't say that. So if you think this way of thinking about faith is sketchy, you are right, because faith does not work that way. I was on some seminary business in the country of Malaysia one time, and concluding my business, I had dinner with a few of the folks from the local church before I was going to fly out the next day, and they said, "Oh, Professor, before you go, we have to pray for our brother who's very, very ill, and you're a great man of God. You have to pray for him." I thought, well, I'm no greater person of faith than any of them, but since they asked, I will pray for them, pray for him. So we gathered together and we prayed earnestly for this person. And then the next morning, I got up and left on the airplane and had no further contact. I don't know if the person was miraculously healed because of our prayers that night, or if he died a few days later. I have no way of knowing. But I do know one thing. His healing could not have come because of me. I know I don't have the gift of faith healing. I would know it if I had it by now. One Sunday morning in another congregation, when we were doing a healing service, just before the early service and I was heading off to church, Carol said to me, "Now, don't actually go healing anybody today." And I said, "What?" She said, "Look, you're already hard enough to live with. I don't need people to think you can now do miracles. I don't have that gift. Not many do. I have prayed for healing with people in this congregation, and, well, we've seen some amazing, miraculous healings. I could recount a number of them. I did that a few weeks ago. That does happen. But then I've also prayed equally earnestly in another congregation for a senior pastor who had just gotten cancer. We prayed just as hard, just as fervently, and within 3 months he was gone. So what's the difference? The healing, or its lack, clearly does not depend on me and my faith, and it doesn't depend on you and your faith. It relies only upon God. That's the way faith works. The disciples said, "Lord, increase our faith." They'd seen his miracles. They were probably wondering, can we do that? Apparently not yet on our own. In chapter 9 of Luke, Jesus sends them out with his authority, and they do some healings, and they cast out demons, and they're amazed. But they knew that those things were based not on their faith, but on Jesus' faith in them. Could Jesus now increase their faith to make them better disciples, to give them more power so they could do better deeds, to proclaim the gospel more loudly, more clearly, more boldly, to win more converts? Could Jesus increase their faith? They wanted a greater amount of faith, as if faith were something that you could turn up like the volume on a radio. But Jesus tells them, it doesn't work that way. The faith of a tiny mustard seed, as Todd said, a tiny mustard seed, that's all you need. God will work with that. It would be enough to say to this mulberry tree, just go throw yourself in the ocean, and it would. Faith is not a commodity that comes in sizes or quantities or volumes. Faith is not something you can dial up or down. Faith is not something you can measure with a ruler or a barometer. Having greater or more faith does not mean that you can do more. Jesus says only a small seed of faith is needed to tell that mulberry bush to go. That's not the way faith works. So how does faith work then? Faith, my friends, is a gift from God. You cannot conjure it up on your own or dial it up as at your desire. In fact, I want to prove that to you with a little experiment. I want you to join me right now. In a moment, I'm going to ask you to count to three, take a deep breath, and then really concentrate right now on increasing your faith. You want to try that with me? All right. 1, 2, 3, take a deep breath, and then try as hard as you can. 1, 2, 3. How did it work? I hate to tell you this, but I don't see any difference. Well, something did happen, actually. You see, you increased the oxygen level in your blood for a moment, because oxygen does work that way. You can do something to increase that. You took a deep breath and your body was filled with life. But did your faith increase? No. Because it doesn't work that way. To increase our faith, you may say, Lord, give me more faith. It would be very similar to saying, Lord, I know that you have made me a homo sapien. I am a human being. But make me more human. Increase my humanness. Or if you're a man, you might say, well, Lord, I know you gave me the gift of being male, but make me more male. Or if you're a woman, you may say, well, Lord, I know you gave me the wonderful gift of being a woman, but make me more a woman. It just doesn't work that way. Faith is a gift given by God, and you cannot get it on your own. I like the way Luther put it. He wrote in this small catechism. Some of you will remember these words from confirmation. He said, I believe that I cannot, by my own reason or strength, believe in Jesus Christ or even come to him. But the Holy Spirit comes to me with the gospel and enlightens me and shows me the way of faith. It's a gift from God. So, my friends, the good news for you today is that you have been made to be human beings, all who have been given the gift of faith. It's yours for all time. It does not wear out. It does not need to grow. It does not even need to mature. It is sufficient on its own to do all that God wants to do for you. You know, God would not give you a half-baked gift any more than you would give a half-baked birthday cake to a child in your home. And here's something more. God certainly would not entrust the value of your faith to you or me. God wouldn't entrust us with something so precious. God gives the gift. It's not up to us to make anything more of it. We would likely mess it up if it were. We would misplace it. We would let it die like an unwatered plant. I know I would, wouldn't you? No, God would not entrust us with determining the value or the possibilities of our faith. God gives us this gift. That's all there is to it. And congratulations again, my friends. That gift has been given to you, and along with it, everything else that God wants to give you. Forgiveness of your sins, as we just found out this morning in our confession. The gift of the Holy Spirit to lead you through life and empower you for service. The gift of victory over death, which means we get to spend an eternity with Christ. None of that depends on you, or the size, or the value, or the quality, or the quantity of your faith. It depends only on God and God's promises to you. For most of us, that promise is fulfilled in our baptism. And that's the way it works. God comes to us then. Now, if you think this is hard to get your mind around, let me share one more little thought experiment. Whose prayer would God more likely hear? The prayer of a 90-year-old woman who has lived her entire life in faith, or the prayer of a 9-year-old child who kneels beside her bedside in her bedtime prayers? Whose prayer would God more likely hear? A person who has served God faithfully for 50 years, or a repentant sinner who has just learned about the love of Jesus 5 days ago? Whose prayer would God most likely hear? A person who has never tasted alcohol, or an addict who calls desperately out to be healed and asking for God to turn their life around, whose prayer would most likely be heard? All of them, of course. All of them equally, because that's the way it works. So, what should we do with this gift? Well, the entire Bible answers that question. You don't have to look far anywhere you turn in the Bible to get the same answer. Love God, love your neighbor. Serve God, serve your neighbor. Let your faith shine through you so that others will see Jesus in you. We say in baptism, let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. I once went to a very trendy coffee shop to get a cup of coffee, and at the counter behind the counter was this really hip-looking barista. He had one of those t-shirts on that revealed his large biceps, which apparently he was very proud of. And on each bicep, he had a tattoo. On one bicep was the name Susie with a bunch of flowers and hearts and things. And on the other bicep was the name Brandy with more flowers and hearts. And he seemed friendly enough, so I said, hey, nice ink. He said, thanks. I said, well, so tell me now, who is Susie? Ah, that is my daughter. She's 3 years old. Oh, that's great. And then who's Brandy? Oh, he said, that was a mistake. He knew that Brandy was going to be there for the rest of his life. In fact, in 100 years, when he's lying in a grave somewhere, that wrinkled old tattoo of Brandy will still be there if anyone would care to look. That's the way tattoos work. It ain't going away. This might be a crude comparison, but that's the way faith is. Once God gives it to you, it's always going to be there. It ain't going away. It's like an eternal tattoo. You know, in baptism, whenever we have one here, you'll see that as the child is baptized, the pastor will say, they'll say their name, and they'll say, you've been sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever. Just like a tattoo. I once baptized a beautiful baby boy. This is quite a number of years ago, early in my ministry. And through the years, I had moved, they had moved, and I found out that the boy, he was in his early 20s. He'd fallen on some pretty hard times. He'd gotten involved with alcohol and then drugs, and then finally, he got involved with heroin, which is about as bad as it gets. Heroin. He was an addict. But his family and his church member friends pulled together, and they got him back into church, and they got him on a sober pathway, and he was doing pretty well. And his father, I happened to be in contact with him, he said, if you ever get the chance, would you go talk to Billy? He could just use your support. Sure, I said, I'd be glad to. So I happened to be in the area that he was living, and so I called him and said, could we get together for coffee? We met at Starbucks, and he came with a couple of young friends from his church who were supporting him. And so we chatted for a while, and then I said, Billy, there's something important I really have to tell you. When I baptized you, you were way too young to remember it, to realize it, but something powerful happened that day. Your parents brought you forward in faith. God met you on that day in faith, and I'm telling you now because I'm sure you don't remember the day as well as I do. God planted the gift of faith within you. And Billy, I marked the sign of the cross on your forehead, and I leaned forward and I made the cross on his forehead as he sat with me over coffee. Right here, I said. I marked the sign of the cross and said, you are marked with the sign of the cross forever. That same gift, Billy, is with you now, giving you strength to face the hard road ahead of you. Then we prayed, Lord, stir up the faith in Billy to give him the strength to meet the difficulty and the challenges ahead, and teach him to serve you as he is being served by these friends here today. Lord, increase our faith, we may pray with the disciples. But here is Jesus' answer. Don't worry. I've already given you all I've got. Amen.
Whose love in humble service bore the weight of human need, who upon the cross forsaken worked your mercy's perfect deed. We, your servants, bring the worship, not a voice alone, but heart. Consecrating to your purpose every gift which you impart. Still your children wander homeless, still the hungry cry for bread, still the captives long for freedom, still in grief we mourn our the sick and freed the soul. By your Spirit, send your power to our world to make it whole. As we worship, grant us vision till your love's revealing light in its height and depth and greatness dawns upon our quickened sight, making known the needs and burdens your compassion bids us bear. Let your servants' ardent service your abundant life to share. To your service, forth in your dear name we go. To the child, the youth, the aged, love in living deeds to show. Help and health, good will and comfort, counsel, aid, and peace we give. Your servants, Lord, in freedom, may your mercy know and live.
Speaking of faith, let's rise together and talk about our faith in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Before we enter into our prayers, I just want to mention that we're very well aware of the fact that we've got a community that views us on Sunday mornings through the internet, through Facebook and YouTube, and though we don't see their faces, they see us, and they are part of our community in some wonderful way, and occasionally they'll notify us of something going on. Someone sent in a prayer request for a young man named Austin Ward, lives in the state of Washington, who had a terrible accident. So we're going to be keeping Austin in our prayers this morning.
Beloved friends, as scattered grains of wheat are gathered together into one bread, so let us gather our prayers for the church, those in need, and all of God's good creation. Loving God, we pray for your holy church here in every place, and for those who serve following the humble example of Christ, for our staff here at Trinity, for all church leaders and workers in our community, and for all who serve in any ministry anywhere in the world. Your church is vast, and your servants are many. Help them to live by faith and walk by the light of your gospel. God of grace, hear our prayer. We pray today for parts of the world ravaged by the tremendous fires and hurricanes. Bring relief to all in the West who continue to face the raging blazes. Bring comfort and relief to all in Puerto Rico, Cuba, and Florida as they recover from the great hurricanes that have brought such devastation to their shores. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
God of all nations, we pray for those entrusted with government authority. Grant our leaders self-discipline in all things and inspire them with love for your people. Above all, lead them in the ways of peace and commit their hearts to ending warfare in Ukraine and in the 60 other nations and regions of the world that are embroiled in battle today. God of grace, God of compassion, we pray for victims of violence, abuse, and neglect. Heal those who have been harmed and protect those who are vulnerable. And we pray for the long list of friends who are ill or as poor who have special needs. Today we pray especially for Lois, Lisa, Katie, Vicky, Christine, Gloria, Therese, Norbert, Mary, Tyler, Logan, John and family. Bring comfort to Rachel, Wayne, Jim, Ken, Kathy, Marlene, Susan, Sherry, and Jim. Restore the health of Sally B., Sandy E., Dave, Kent, Tim, Sandy, Sherry, Lauren, Jim, Jeff, Tom, and Ted. God of grace. Gracious God, we pray for this and every congregation. Rekindle your gifts within your people and inspire councils, committees, and individuals to plan and work together that all may know your love. Inspire us to be generous in giving of our personal time and in sharing our wealth. God of grace.
And loving God, we pray today for Austin. Lay your hand of healing upon him as he recovers from his accident and his upcoming surgery. God of grace, hear our prayer. Gathered together in the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, gracious God, we offer these and all our prayers to you through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always. And please share with one another some sign of God's peace.
Let us pray. God of all creation, all you have made is good, and your love endures forever. You bring forth bread from the earth and fruit from the vine. Nourish us with these gifts, that we might be for the world signs of your gracious presence in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
With you.
Lift up your hearts.
Let
us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, O Lord, Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave and won for us the glorious resurrection for all of us and the forgiveness of our sins. And so with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we join their unending hymn. Our Lord Jesus took bread. He broke it and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body broken for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup. He blessed it and he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Pour out upon us, loving God, the Spirit of Christ, who gave himself for our sins, and who also taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. As you come forward in a moment for the bread and the wine, this is gluten-free bread. I believe it has some egg product in it, in case that matters to anyone. We also have grape juice in the inner circle, the white grape juice in the inner circle on the trays. And for those who prefer, you can still use those little prepackaged kits. If you just come forward and ask for that, we'll hand that to you instead. So all is prepared.
We walk by faith and not by sight, with gracious words draw near. O Christ, who spoke as none e'er spoke, my peace be with you here. We may not touch your hands and side, nor follow where you trod, but in your promise we rejoice and cry, "My Lord and God."
Body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you. Amen.
Let us pray. God, we give you thanks that you have set before us this feast, the body and blood of your Son. By your Spirit, strengthen us to serve all in need and to give ourselves away as bread for the hungry, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
My friends, now as you go forth into this week, I want you to take this blessing with you, letting you know that God is with you through all of the challenges and all the joys that you will face. Sing together our closing song.
Sorrow till we've seen this journey.
Go in peace. Serve the Lord.